So please introduce Stella Lord. Stella has been a women's rights and social justice activist since her early 30s. She developed a keen interest in poverty in the early 1980s when she lived in Victoria, BC, and worked on various projects related to women's poverty and later as legislative assistant to MLA Rosemary Brown. Stella has an MA in political science and a PhD in sociology. She taught courses in women's studies, sociology, and political science at St. Mary's University for 15 years and was a policy analyst with the Nova Scotia Advisory Council on the Status of Women for 10 years. After she retired in 2004, she completed her PhD thesis on single parents and welfare reform in Nova Scotia and became more active in anti-poverty work. She took on the volunteer job of coordinating the Community Society to End Poverty in Nova Scotia in 2011. And her talk today is entitled ESIA Transformations in Nova Scotia, Why We Need a Coordinated Plan with Teeth.
Hi, thanks very much for that introduction. Just a slight change of title. It's called ESI Transformation, Why We Need Federal and Provincial Poverty Reduction Strategies with Teeth. So just a little clarification. Yes, I'm supposed to get them to roll up.
Strategy in Nova Scotia since about 2007, as well as focusing on, and we didn't get very far with that, as you might have noticed, but, so although we do advocate for a poverty reduction strategy, we have focused a lot, most of our attention on income assistance, ESIA program, for changes in that program and for increased benefits and so on and so forth. So that's where we've been, and that's why I've been involved in tracking the ESI transformation process, which was announced in 2014 basically, but they didn't really get around to actually doing much in the community or engaging the community until this past summer. what is ESIA? It stands for Employment Support and Income Assistance Program. It's a provincial income support program of last resort within Canada's social security system, such as it is. As Fiona explained in the last presentation before last, it's a needs-based program. Eligibility is based on the difference between an applicant's resources and eligible expenses. And I really do have to emphasize the eligible expenses, because they set up a budget that is for eligible expenses. So it's based on what we call a budget deficit model. The deficit between their budget that they've already defined and what resources an individual has or a family has that applies. The ESIA Act was enacted in 2001. It had emerged as a successor to the municipal income assistance programs, which were administered through the municipalities. There were about 52 around the province at the time until the early 90s, all with different income assistance rates. They were amalgamated with the Provincial Family Benefits Program, which was a provincial program for people who were deemed at that time not necessarily able to look for work, at least in the short term. So they were deemed long-term recipients. These were mainly single parents and people with disabilities. The process of developing the ESIA program was partly defined by a federal social security review, which started in 1994. One of the things that came out of that was the demise of the Canada Assistance Plan, which Fiona also alluded to, that had some very minimum requirements for the administration and delivery of provincial income assistance programs in exchange for 50-50 cost sharing. At the moment, the province only gets 25% funding from the federal government for income assistance and social services. So that's been an issue. It's the background to some of the problems we're facing today. The amalgamation of municipal income assistance with family benefits occurred kind of during that period, and I have to say that Mike Savage's father, John Savage, was largely responsible for that in the province. In some ways it was a good thing. I mean, people have been advocating that for that for years, but unfortunately it also occurred in the context of a cuts in funding federally. I'm sure if John Savage was alive he would not be happy with the outcome. So the regulations in 2001 came out with a new benefit structure in which a few people got a little bit more, especially people living in rural areas who had previously been under municipal assistance where the rates were absolutely really disgusting. A lot of people in Metro Halifax and certainly single parents got less. But it was a kind of evening out of the benefit structure. But what they also did was introduce stronger employability requirements for family benefits recipients. This was single parents on income assistance. And at the time, I don't know if you remember, but there's a lot of talk about the welfare wall for single parents, the need to get single parents off the system. And at that time, it's certainly true that I think about over 70% of the provincial caseload were single parents. That has significantly changed for a couple of reasons, which you can ask me about later if you like. So why does ESI need to change? Well, I'm not going to go through the list of reasons. You heard a lot of very good reasons from Fiona and Jeff's presentations earlier. Welfare is historically being based on the principle of less eligibility, which basically means that, was originally enshrined, by the way, in the Elizabethan poor law that developed in Britain in the 16th century. And unfortunately, the principle's underlying assumptions haven't changed a heck of a lot since then. That principle ensures that welfare benefits must pay less than the lowest wage. In other words, the assumption is that you cannot give benefits to people on welfare more than what they were doing, could earn in the labour market. Hence the importance of thinking about increasing minimum wage. Welfare incomes are currently between 25 and 50% below any measure of poverty. It doesn't matter which measure you use. There's a low income cutoff, the LICO, the market basket measure, which actually tells you how much you need to live a basic, kind of have a basic living, livable income. I mean, not really livable income, very basic income. And the low income measure, which is the measure that's used internationally. The rules and regulations to maintain this assumptions, principle of less eligibility, they promote lack of control over decision making, as Fiona explained, reliance on charity. We actually went to one presentation about the proposed income assistance changes in which they were showing a social security system for Nova Scotia, and they had food banks in the outer circle of support for people living in poverty. Food banks and shelters. Social stigma, heard about that. Social exclusion, invasion of privacy. They deny basic human rights, and it's certainly bad for health and well-being. So, why is DCS transforming the system? Transforming is a nice word. 5 years ago or so, people in the radical left and women's movement talk about transformational change. So we were kind of hopeful about this whole use of the word transforming. This sounds good, and I should say, I was going to say right at the beginning of this, that the reason I'm here, I'm here with lots of questions and a glimmer of hope. Okay, so why is ECS transforming ESIA? Most of what I'm going to say in the next lot of slides come from the PowerPoint presentation that the department did for the engagement sessions with quote unquote stakeholders in the summer. In addition to that, I've also used the RFP document, the request for proposals for a tender for them to hire a consulting firm to do most of the work on this. So that's the reference. You can get it online, this online, if you want to go into the tenders and procurement site of the provincial website. It's a very long document. I spent ages trying to kind of filter it down and distill it into what it is exactly that we want to do. We've also had the group that I work with, we have an ESI working group, and we've had a few meetings with the department to clarify certain things. as well. So my presentation relies on those three sources, I guess. So the first thing you want to talk about is costs. They say that the system is labor intensive, and obviously it is, with all those intrusive measures going on, having to fill forms out, keeping track of people on income systems. It's expensive to administer. They admit the system is not transparent and it's confusing for clients. They argue that it promotes dependency and requires people to sacrifice their long-term interests, quote unquote, i.e. their independence, to access programs. A lot of assumptions about dependency, that people have an easy life on income assistance and so on and so forth. So we did challenge that kind of language. They admit that it doesn't enable social inclusion, so they're aware of that. They know it creates stigma, that it doesn't always meet basic needs for shelter, food, and other necessities. Their other concern is that the outcomes of the system are not easily measured. In other words, they don't have a way of tracking how people on income assistance are doing in terms of health or well-being or anything else, really. The other concern that is around the caseload, which I'll get into in a minute, but the system is not set up to treat different clients differently. In other words, they have a large part of their caseload now. The largest part of their caseload is not single parents, it's people with disabilities. Various kinds of disabilities, either physical or mental health disabilities, episodic disabilities, whatever you want to call it. But they're basically people who can, for one reason or another, not seek employment. And seeking employment is, of course, being a part of that fundamental principle of less eligibility, supposed to look for work. So the system relies heavily on special needs funding. In a minute, I think, one of the reasons why it relies heavily on special needs funding is because the basic income assistance rates are terrible. They haven't increased, this is the third year where there's been no increase. It's way, way below the poverty line. People certainly cannot afford to pay for quote-unquote special needs out of their basic benefits. And many of the people on income assistance, as I just said, have health or related issues around health, disabilities, and so on. So DCS transformation is one part of what the department says is their interrelated departmental strategic goals. These are some of them. They sound really good. Just to be fair to some people in the department, I have to say this, that there are some, some people in the department who really do want to see change. But of course they're working, they're some of the senior, middle management, senior bureaucrats, and I'm sure people on the front lines as well want to see change. But they are faced with a government that increasingly wants to balance the budget and is busy introducing austerity measures. Anyhow, these are the four big goals of the department. It's not all to do with income assistance, of course. There is supposed to be a program that is going to help people with disabilities. I have heard that that is now significantly on hold. They have recently made changes to the Child Welfare Act. There are a lot of issues around that. A lot of people in this room that I know were involved in advocating on that group was, because they wanted to define child neglect as not being able to feed and clothe your family. We pointed out that anybody on income assistance couldn't do that, so when were they going to change the income assistance program? Anyway, so they did change some language in that Child Welfare Act, glad to say. And they want to improve the sustainability of social service system. So, in the initial document, the engagement document, they identified some challenges that DCS and the ESIA system is facing. One is that systemic and policy outcomes are not being met. The document, in my view, did not take the little items in red that I put in here are the questions that we've been asking DCS, and that we thought, and we have in fact posed some of these questions to DCS and challenged them to answer them. We didn't think that the challenges that they mentioned really considered many of the economic changes. They focus very much on demographic changes, changes in their system, in their caseload, not the background issues that we heard about this morning around precarious employment and some of those issues. We asked that they said the people who enter tend to stay in or return to income assistance, implying this whole dependency issue again, the language of dependency came up. We challenged them to think about why, in the context of the labor market, in the context of our other systems of support, in the context of the healthcare system. We think we have a universal healthcare system, I beg to differ, when we can't get dental care and vision care and supports for people with disabilities through the healthcare system. So we challenge them to think about that. And surprise, surprise, the system has limited success supporting sustained labor market attachment for clients. But we heard about precarious employment. We know that there's a crisis in wages. We know that people are not able to live really adequately on the minimum wage, especially if they have a dependent. By the way, just on the minimum wage, I should say that the minimum wage, base minimum wage, is established. There is a committee that looks at it every year and does increase it by the cost of living on a yearly basis. But the base minimum wage in this province is set at the poverty rate, LICO, for a single person living in Sydney. A single person. So basically, there is no way that if you are earning, if you are on minimum wage and you have any kind of dependent, that you are able to be out of poverty. So the next challenges were the financial and caseload trends. They were concerned that their caseload decreased by 16% after 2000 because they introduced these more stringent employability requirements. That was part of the reason. The other reason, I think, is that the federal government did introduce the national child benefit and the child tax benefit, refundable tax credit, which I think enabled a lot of single parents to get off welfare and usually take a minimum wage job, which would be supplemented by the child tax benefit, because it was, they were eligible for it whether they worked or not. It was big income based. There's been overall cost increases since 2005. The caseload did go down quite a bit after 2000. It's increased since 2005, but there was no mention of the recession, the 2008 recession, which was the biggest recession we've probably experienced since the 1930s. You know, they, again, looking just internally at their own systems. Why is it because the system's too generous? People on income assistance get more than the minimum wage, good grief. And, you know, what other things are keeping people on income assistance? Well, we said, kind of look around. Over 75% of the clients on income assistance receive special needs. And this has increased, apparently, over the last 10 years or so. And again, we said, well, it's not surprising. Most of your caseload is now people with disabilities who have special needs that are not included in the basic allowance. There's no specific disability allowance for people on income assistance, so that's no surprise either. And the other thing is that, you know, the income assistance rates themselves, welfare incomes, have not kept up with the cost of living and are going down in relation. The poverty gap is widening between welfare incomes and poverty line. Now, this is an interesting point, and I think they admit this. 400 casework staff spend up to 75% of their time on administrative tasks. That is, filling out forms, getting other people to fill out forms, getting doctors to fill out forms, getting clients to fill out forms, you name it, they do it. So the paperwork, as we pointed out, especially for special needs, is horrendous, is absolutely horrendous at the moment. So they want, they do want to change that. The third challenge, which we really seriously took issue with them again, is that the system creates a disincentive to work. And the example they gave, as I said earlier, a single mother with two children working at minimum wage compared with the same household on income assistance in order to demonstrate that there was a difference, that in fact the person minimum on minimum wage earned 2,400 more than the person on income assistance. But the inference of what they were saying was that that was too small of an increase, too small of a gap, and the inference is that, was it, what was the inference? That's what we asked. Well, what are you trying to say? Are you trying to say that the minimum wage is too low? I would agree with that. Or are you trying to say that the income assistance or welfare income is too high? And that these people are doing very well, and if we reduce that, we increase that gap, there'll be more of an incentive to work. So we really challenged them on that. And said it was giving the totally wrong message. They did anything else we've got from them has actually not said disincentives to work, they focused more on incentives to work. So the transformation objectives. As you'll realize from what I've already been saying, there is not a consistent message within these objectives. And I think that reflects a bit of a struggle within the department. As I said earlier, I think there are people within the department, I could name at least five in senior management positions, who seriously want to make change for the better. There are others who are more concerned with the dollars, more concerned with the spending, more concerned with cutting spending. And of course they're working within a system now, particularly, where there is real pressure to cut departmental spending. And they're having to, you know, the department's having to step up to the plate every year and say, hey, we're going to save $500,000 put this in your budget and smoke it. But so there's conflicting pressures from the government, from some people inside the department, and so on. Anyhow, you know, so these objectives sound okay, especially the one for clients, I guess. Certainly for services, make it more streamlined, a little bit, again, balanced with resources. For government, support economic growth through improved labor force participation. So again, we have that focus on labor force participation. So those are the big high-level objectives. These are actually what the government wants to achieve, what DCS itself wants to achieve. They want to streamline service delivery, segment the caseload. Now this is an interesting one. I'll talk about that in a minute. They want to target interventions based on the segmented caseload. They want to define adequacy. What would be an adequate level of income? What is an adequate welfare income for different people, for different groups in the segmented system? And they want to simplify administration. So transformation will take place in three phases. Phase one has been completed. Basically, that started in the summer of 2015. Well, no, I should say it started earlier than that, because they were starting to research this in the fall of 2014. So phase one was department research. They built some plans and some ideas based on some of the feedback from the from their research. They developed this high-level framework, which we're going to talk about in a minute, or the basic objectives that we've just discussed. They got cabinet support to proceed at least for phase two. Phase three, which is actually the most interesting bit, they haven't yet. As I read the RFP, I don't think they have yet got cabinet approval for. And they've also conducted stakeholder engagement session in August, and have recently completed a first voice consultations, which we've also had occasion to talk to them about, because of the way they rolled that out. Instead of asking the community how, what would be a good way to do this, they went ahead and did the survey, which some people couldn't fill in, didn't have access to the needed materials, the internet, of course. But they did do some first voice focus groups. We argued that they didn't do enough and they weren't that accessible, so they are going to try and do a second round of focus groups based on the findings from the first round. And we gather that in the first round, they got an earful about special needs. Well, they got an earful about a lot of things, I gather, on my conversations with people on income assistance, but certainly on special needs. So that I think they're quite concerned about that. So phase two, they're now in the process of phase two. And basically, they're relying on these external consultants, which will be paid almost $1 million to do this work, to provide professional support and advice, basically, and kind of develop the implementation plan and so on and so forth. So this is what the external consultants are responsible for. I won't read them all, you know, read. Phase three will cover 2017 and beyond. So phase two, I should have said, phase two is supposed to be implemented by the end, or at least in place by the end of this year, and I suspect if there are any kind of financial changes, they will be reflected in the 2017 budget. However, I have to say, I think they're a bit behind schedule. So I'm not sure where that stands. We're trying to find out. Phase three and beyond, and this is where it gets a bit more interesting. They want to identify additional administrative improvements which they will look at in phase two. They want to make a business case for standard household rate, which means that they won't divide between personal allowance and shelter allowance. It will at least be one envelope, because people get nickel to dime to death on that issue as well. They tell people, you know, I mean, the highest housing allowance is $535, right, for an individual with a disability. Now, other housing allowances are based on the numbers in the family and so on. But, you know, they've been telling people, oh, I'm sorry, you can't spend $535, you know, you're not really, you're not classified as disabled, so, you know, you can find somewhere for less than that, this kind of thing. They're going to do a business case, policy analysis, and a business case for income security options. And the last thing they're going to do, which is a feasibility for a new approach for income security for all low-income Nova Scotians or subpopulations. I should say that the last two things are actually only the first thing is going to be implemented according to the RFP. The other three things, which are probably the most interesting and the most forward-looking, they're only making a business case for. So what I'd like to propose, and what I think I'm hoping we will do, is to support those people in the department who want to push this forward, who want to move beyond income assistance as a needs-based program of last resort, and move a little bit further than that. And I think that's where some of the senior people in the department want to go. Phase two, so back to phase two. Streamlining service delivery, these are the things that they're looking at. I'm sure many of you in the room can relate to some of these things they want to look at. They do want to cut down on these regulatory things around letters and correspondence and monthly letters to clients and all this kind of stuff. So that, I think, will be a benefit. As you see, they want to use online tools for some of this. This could be problematic for a lot of clients. As Amy has said, most people, and many people on income assistance, don't have access to internet, never mind use it. So we've raised this, and they claim that they're going to use service-based organizations, libraries, suggested, who could actually help people access and navigate the systems. The phase two client, as a client segment, now segmenting the client base. So they're proposing to do this according to proximity to the labor market and the requirements for special kinds of support. So their proposal is to divide the caseload between people who have no employment obligations, and where there are significant limitations to employment that are not likely to change. In other words, this is people with disabilities. We're not sure whether that will include people with episodic disabilities, people with mental health issues, and so on and so forth. You know, how these are going to be divided is a question that remains. Transitional, these are people who will get the most kind of active interventions in terms of finding, you know, probably getting short-term training to find a job. And then there's people, they say, who are employable, i.e. ready to enter the labor market, plus people who've run out of their ER, people like that. So that's how they're planning to do that. Targeted interventions, We've asked the question, what kind of targeted interventions, what kind of supports are going to be made available? They should be significantly better than what they are now. The fourth thing we want to do is define adequacy. It will probably be done internally within the department in phase two, but I doubt will be rolled out before phase three. So they want to do a discussion of that. We've already discussed with them this METAS stands for the marginal effective tax rate. So they want to, in the long term, they want to even make a gradual increase using the refundable tax credit system, federally and provincially, try and make a gradual, make a system that instead of bumping up and down, like if you get the working income tax benefit, which you're eligible for if you earn $3,000, and that kind of drops down at I don't know what income it is, but you suddenly lose it. They want to kind of even these out, so it is actually a better income support program. And of course, they'll have to work with the federal government on that if they want to do a good job. A lot of these income supports, refundable tax credits, have their own thresholds, their own starting points and their own thresholds. Certainly the increase in the Canada Child Benefit will play a key part in this and should be very helpful if they want to move that into that direction. I wanted to move to the next one first. So they want to simplify the administration and planning, I think, certainly will be very good. They want to make a business case and a cost analysis of a standard household rate and so on. Our concern here is what's going to happen to special needs? There's very little mention of special needs in this whole document, this whole process. And I think one of the things they said, they want to bundle special needs into the basic allowance. But what they've been talking about is telephone and transportation, which is would certainly be an advance in the right direction. They're going to include that in basic rates. But what happens to all kinds of other special needs? Special diet allowances, things for equipment, health-related things. And I don't think they've really thought that out. Sorry, I'm a little bit messed up here. I guess I see you standing there, and I just want to get some positive message, my main message out here. There are some positive elements in the transformation plan. Less reporting, scrutiny, etc., if they really go through, and they seem to be committed to doing that with their administrative service reforms. Will services be easier to navigate if they're online? They will be for some, but not for everyone, perhaps. And how that's going to be handled. They seem committed to the savings they make on administration, to directing these resources to clients and to services. They want to make services targeted to specific client needs, and they want to make one benefit envelope. That will certainly be good. Finally, they want to coordinate and align federal and provincial refundable tax credits to develop an income-based approach, but that's not in the implementation section of the plan, as far as I know. It's let's do a business plan model, let's do an assessment, let's do a feasibility study, and maybe we should help them on with the petition here. And the final thing is they want to extend a kind of income-based program to all low-income Nova Scotians, which of course would be beneficial. So these are some of the issues we're considering. This is a slide I meant to show before the other previous slide. I got it mixed up, sorry. So those are some of the things that they that we are concerned about. I've been through them already. And basically what I'm arguing in here is that it's very, all very well for the department to be doing this. And you know, I'm supportive of some of the things they want to do, making changes. I think it's really important because the system is a total mess at the moment. So I'd say, yes, let's support it as far as it goes. But as I think we've seen, it needs to be a broader plan. They need to break down the silos, as somebody was talking about this morning, between departments and work with across government on some of these issues. They need to work better with labor and advanced education, even the Justice Department, Health Department, education, the Department of Education, which is now responsible for childcare. So we need a comprehensive plan, which these are some of the things that should be in a comprehensive plan with targets and measurable outcomes that are reportable to the public, for which they are accountable. We need these federally and provincially. And the provincial government can't do all these things on their own. There has to be federal investment. I think we have to realize that. And we are in a much better place than we were 5 years ago, or 7 years ago, I guess, when we first started advocating for a provincial poverty reduction strategy. We do have a federal government that I think is on board with the idea of poverty reduction. They are going to be holding hearings again in the summer. Mike Savage alluded to the report that they did when he was in government, and hopefully they can pick up on that and not just reinvent the wheel, because there were some good things in those reports that he was talking about. But there will be hearings in the summer, and these are, this list here, which I'm going to read, should be part of any poverty reduction plan, federally and provincially. So I think in terms of strategy, I think we need to pressure certainly the federal government for their plan. We need to talk again with the province about going broader than community services, to look across government, to break down the silos to really address poverty. We need to talk about, we need to also pressure the government about their austerity approach, which I think is, you know, could be a real stumbling block in what some of the final things that the department wants to do. And hopefully maybe we'll have a provincial election before that. We need to ensure that the province moves towards the final goal, not just doing a business case. We don't want the business case to be the final goal and then it gets buried in some government office. We need some real plans to enact that, and I think it's up to all of us in this room to make sure they actually go in that direction. Thank you.